My name is Leslie Morris. I'm the program director for the Model System Center here, and I'd like to welcome all of you, for those who have been here previously and for those who are joining us for the first time. Thank you for attending this evening. We're webcasting this evening's lecture to 30 states nationwide and internationally, to countries as far as Canada, India, New Zealand, Portugal, and Mexico. And I know that many of you in the room are very excited to hear this evening's lecture from our esteemed colleagues from Louisville, Kentucky. They're here tonight to talk about approach to spinal cord injury medicine. Dr. Steve Williams and Dr. Mike Stillman are very well known in the Boston community. They're well known internationally as clinicians and researchers in the SCI community, and we're very, very fortunate to have them this evening. Mike Stillman will be our first speaker. Dr. Stillman is an assistant professor of internal medicine and neurosurgery at University of Louisville School of Medicine. He runs a primary care clinic for patients with chronic disabilities and spinal cord injuries at Fraser Rehab Institute, and he teaches internal medicine residents in the primary care clinic. Dr. Stillman is funded through both the Kentucky Spinal Cord Injury Research Center and the Department of Defense. He is specifically interested to access and healthcare for people living with spinal cord injury and cardiometabolic disease and chronic spinal cord injury. And after his talk, Dr. Steve Williams will speak. Dr. Williams is Professor of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, Chief of Spinal Cord Medicine, and Director of Translational Research at the Department of Neurological Surgery at the University of Louisville School of Medicine in Fraser Rehab and Neuroscience Center. He is co-principal investigator of the Kentucky Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center. Prior to his arrival in Kentucky, Dr. Williams served as chairman of the Department of Rehabilitation Medicine at Boston University School of Medicine and chief of rehabilitation services at Boston Medical Center for 9 years. So thank you both for coming, and Dr. Stillman.
Thank you so much. Can everybody hear me? Okay. If I leave the podium, I'm not going to grab the microphone. I have kind of a loud voice. So again, my name is Mike Stillman. I'm sorry? Speak into it. Is this better? Okay. Maybe I can just hold it. Does this work? Okay. My name is Mike Stillman. I'm a primary care doc, so I'm an internist. I specialize in internal medicine, and I'm on faculty at University of Louisville. And as Leslie just said, I'm sharing the podium tonight with Steve Williams. It's a little bit of an intimidating task. The people maybe outside of this area may not know Steve as well, but he, for many years, was a very beloved and important figure in the medical community in Boston. And so I understand I'm the afterthought, and that's okay. we're both really grateful to be here tonight, and we're particularly grateful to Leslie, who coordinates this lecture series and who is so helpful in bringing us back to Boston. Steve's been here a couple of more times than I have, but I've barely been back since we moved to Louisville 2 years ago. So it's really a pleasure being here. And to Judy Zazula, who is really the driving force behind bringing us here. And they're both wonderful administrators and researchers and very old friends and colleagues. So thank you both so much for having us this evening. And as you know, we're here to discuss integrated care for people with spinal cord injuries. It's a very important subject and one that's very, very hot on both of our plates these days. We have three goals for the lecture tonight. First of all, we're going to review the problems that people with spinal cord injury face when seeking health care. I'm going to take this first task, and then I'll hand the microphone off to Steve, and he'll take the second two tasks, that is to share University of Louisville's model for coordination of care. It's something that we think is useful to people with spinal cord injury, but is not complicated and is easily kind of exported to other rehabilitation centers and other hospitals. And then Steve will end the talk discussing an emerging concept in integrated care for people with spinal cord injury that we're kind of in the process of developing at Fraser in Louisville, and really we think calls upon the best talents of our clinical team, that's the two of us, and the therapy staff and the research staff. As I go over the problems that folks with spinal cord injuries face when seeking health care, I'm going to do it by way of a literature review. So I'll tell you that Steve and I spent a lot of time going over the medical literature. We pulled some kind of cornerstone articles discussing this issue, and we'll quickly review those with you. And neither one of us has any conflicts to disclose. Neither one of us is very good at PowerPoint. I, in fact, only learned how to use this program a couple of years ago when my residents started calling me a caveman and accusing me of living in the 1980s. So this is about as fancy as it gets. This is mostly for the Boston audience. Do any of you actually know where Kentucky is on a map? Good. No offense to anybody who lives in Kentucky or is in the Midwest right now listening to this lecture, but it struck me when we moved to Kentucky in the summer of 2012, I had only been on one recruiting trip to University of Louisville, and I really didn't even know where Louisville was on a map, so I thought we'd orient the audience here to it. You can see Louisville's in the center of the slide. It's kind of in the north-central part of the state of Kentucky, and you can see Kentucky itself is centrally located in the country. It's actually farther west than I had imagined. It borders seven other states, and you can see Louisville is actually west of Ohio, which kind of came as a shock to me. You can also see that Louisville's right on the Ohio River. Just across the river is Indiana. We have a nice view of that state. Sometimes we go have dinner or brunch over there. When we first started doing that, our friends in Boston thought it was very exotic, like we were going on safari. But it's a good place. We've taken a road trip or two up to Indianapolis to go shopping. It has better malls than Louisville does. And this is, in fact, Louisville. If any of you haven't seen it, this is taken from the Indiana aspect of the Ohio River. You can see it's a big city with an interesting and vibrant downtown area. The city has about 750,000 people. And this is Fraser Rehab Institute. I told you I wasn't so good at PowerPoint, and so this is kind of the best I could do with this slide. But you can see it's an enormous facility right in the middle of our health science campus, and you can also see that there was significant new construction within the last decade. So it's really a modern and well-equipped facility. And more than that, and I was talking to one of our old colleagues from Boston Medical Center here tonight, the staff there are really purpose-driven in their work. And so I think Steve and I feel a great sense of gratitude when we go into work every morning, knowing that we're going to this institution where we're all really working collaboratively to provide the best possible care to people with chronic disabilities, and in particular, in our case, to folks with spinal cord injuries. We always start lectures looking at the scope of the problem. So, you know, we want to talk about the demographics of spinal cord injury, and the truth is that the numbers around this medical condition remain kind of murky. So the NSCIA suggests that just over 250,000 Americans are living with spinal cord injury. The Reeve Foundation had assembled a panel some years back to take a closer look at the demographics, and they found that closer to 1.3 million Americans are living with a spinal cord injury. The Reeve Foundation parenthetically suggested that about 5 million Americans are living with some form of paralysis, but that the majority of them are paralyzed not from an injury, but rather from a stroke or MS or some other neurologic disease or insult. We know that just over half of people living with spinal cord injury have tetraplegia. We know that the average age, time of injury is increasing. So in the 1970s, this was very much a young person's disease. The average age at injury was 29. Now it's in the low 40s. And we also know that life expectancy for people with spinal cord injury is slowly improving. So I didn't include this in a slide, but there was a very elegant review on aging with spinal cord injury written by Suzanne Groa a couple of years ago. And she put in a graph showing that for people with most levels and severity of injury over the last 15 years, life expectancy has gone up by between 2 and 4 years. That's not true for people who are reliant on ventilators, but it's true for most other folks, and that's very encouraging. We could certainly do more in that area, but we're going in the right direction. I told you I wanted to start this talk looking at access to care, and I want to tell you a couple of things before we delve into the literature. First of all, as I said, this is an important issue to Steve and me, and I think to everybody in this room and in this audience. What we know, and I'm going to go over what we know, but what we know is that people with spinal cord injury do not have equal access to health care in this country, and the care that they receive isn't as thorough as people who don't have injuries. And so that really makes this talk all the more important in the work that, for instance, Bethlen is going to do at Boston Medical Center. The other thing I want to tell you is that when you do a literature search looking at access to care in this country, there's a rather broad literature looking at how people with disabilities access and utilize healthcare services. But in the medical literature, the term disability is very broad. It includes people with conditions as dissimilar as severe knee arthritis or schizophrenia or spinal cord injury, and you can imagine that people with these different medical conditions may have non-overlapping and very unique concerns when they seek healthcare. So it's very difficult to extrapolate from that very broad and in certain ways non-specific literature and to say anything specific about people with spinal cord injury. In the literature looking at how people with injuries access healthcare is very small. So we'll look at some of these studies. I'll tell you which one of these studies specifically address concerns of people living with injuries, but this is a hole in the medical literature, and it's one that we have to fill. So when Steve and I were thinking about this talk, we realized that there are kind of different ways to approach the discussion of access to care. There are different facets of this discussion that we can address. And one way to look at it is to ask patients with injuries or with chronic disabilities how they think we're doing. So these are reports from patients themselves. And we just pulled three cornerstone studies. The first one was written in 2001 by Albina Veldman. She was a researcher in Toronto. And this is a small study, but it's very well quoted. People talk about it a lot. She surveyed people in the Toronto area who had recently been discharged from rehabilitation hospitals or who were members of local disability organizations, and she asked how they access healthcare. And what she found was very troubling. She found that a third of them said that they had difficulties accessing healthcare based solely on their disabilities, and over a third of them said that they couldn't access all of the equipment in their primary care offices. Very troubling. The next study we chose to tell you about was by Thilo Kroll. This was in 2006, and this was a very different kind of study. So this wasn't so much data-driven, but he assembled, if you will, a focus group of people living with disabilities in Northern Virginia, and it was a narrative-based study. So we just kind of put a microphone in the middle of the table and said, tell us about your experiences seeking healthcare. And what he found was that there were very high rates of report of structural, environmental, and process barriers to care. So structural, environmental barriers are the obvious ones. They're physical barriers. They're narrow hallways. They're inaccessible doorways. They're inaccessible restrooms. But the process barriers are much more subtle and equally powerful. And these are attitudinal barriers. These are staff in medical offices who are ill-equipped to see to the specific concerns of people living with disabilities. They're physicians who are inadequately educated about how to take care of people with injuries or with disabilities. So that was also a very powerful and troubling study. In this third study we listed was by Catherine Donnelly. She was a Canadian researcher. She teamed up with some collaborators in Colorado and in the UK.
By the way, in Kentucky, when we say UK, it means University of Kentucky. I don't know if anyone's a Wildcats fan. We're not. We're at University of Louisville. They pay our paychecks, but just so. She had collaborators in Colorado and in the UK. And this was a study looking specifically at healthcare for people with spinal cord injuries. So again, one of the few, and it was a very broad-ranging study. But what I wanted to tell you right now is that in the United States, nearly 30% of subjects with spinal cord injuries said that they couldn't use all of the equipment in their primary care offices. Again, very damning. The second facet of access to care we can look at is compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act. So you all know that the ADA was passed in the early 1990s, nearly 25 years ago, in an effort to ensure that all public facilities, including medical facilities in this country, are equally accessible to all Americans. And despite the fact that law has been on the book for such a long time, there have only been two studies looking at how outpatient medical facilities comply with the ADA. A bit shocking. The first one that came out was by Ellen Grayboy. It was in 1999, and she surveyed all of the primary care offices in a single Texas county. And by primary care, she included general internal medicine, family medicine, OB-GYN. And she sent a huge survey. There were a lot of questions on it. And one notable result was that the average responding office said that it was about 75% compliant with regulations detailed in the ADA. So she listed these regulations and she said, is your office in compliance or is it not? And the average responding office said it was about 75% compliant. But when you actually dig into the answers, you find that these offices, even if they're 75% compliant, maybe are not functionally compliant. So she found, for instance, that virtually none of them, only about 2% of them, had access to platform scales. So people who came in using wheelchairs or people with spinal cord injuries really couldn't get weighed. As a primary care doc, that's very important to me, you know, to monitor people's nutritional statuses. And she found that under a third of these offices had adjustable height examination tables. Now, for people who are not disabled or for people who don't have spinal cord injuries, this seems like a trivial point, but it really isn't. The ADA says that every medical office in this country has to have at least one table that can be dropped to between 17 and 19 inches of the ground to allow for safe and dignified transfer of patients with disabilities. And in this study, under a third of the offices had that. So these exam tables are inaccessible to folks with disabilities. One thing that struck us both about this study is that part of the survey was about how physicians examine wheelchair-using patients. And what she found is that half of the physicians surveyed said that they examined folks in wheelchairs while they were still in their wheelchairs. As somebody who teaches in a primary care clinic, that makes my hair stand up. I always tell my medicine residents, and we don't have a lot of people coming into our clinic in wheelchairs or with injuries, but I say you have to get your patients undressed. You have to get them up on a table. How are you going to do a thorough skin exam on them? How are you going to do a complete vascular exam or an abdominal exam? How are you going to do pelvic exams on women? These physicians were not doing that. The second study in this area of ADA compliance was done just a year later by Jill Sanchez, and this one was done in Illinois, and she kind of did the gray boy study, but she did her one better. So she sent out a survey to 40 practices in Illinois, and she asked them about how they handled folks with disabilities and how compliant they were. And, you know, predictably, all these practices wrote back, and they said, we're fully accessible. We got no problems taking care of folks with disabilities. But then Sanchez and her team descended on these offices and actually measured them for ADA compliance. And what she found is that, you know, again, during the survey, they all said, we're fully accessible, we got no issues at all. But when she went there, she found that only 2 out of the 40 sites had ADA-compliant restrooms. And while on the survey, 40% of these offices said they had adjustable height examination tables, in fact, only 17% of them did. So the Sanchez study is important in that it was the first to report a gap between reports of accessibility and actual accessibility in ADA compliance. And, you know, I don't think anyone believes that there's malice in that reporting gap, but I think what it points to is that even healthcare professionals don't really understand accessibility. We don't understand the concept of it, and we don't understand the measures we have to enact to make sure that our facilities are fully accessible. And then the third facet of access to care we wanted to look at, and this is very powerful, is receipt of preventative care. That is, do people living with spinal cord injury get the same routine and preventative care that those of us who are not injured receive? And the answer to that is likely no. So there have only been really 2 studies looking at this. The other one I didn't mention was done in New Jersey, but this is probably the best quoted study in this area. This was done by Sherry Lavella. She's a researcher out of the VA. She's very well published. And in 2006, she did this very elegant study. So she had 2 groups of subjects. They were all women. They were all getting their care in the same VA system, so there really shouldn't have been any difference in their care. And she looked at receipt of appropriate screening for colon cancer, for breast cancer, for cervical cancer, and annual dental care appointments. And you can see here that the women with injuries received significantly fewer preventative services than the women who did not have injuries.
And with our concerns in mind, Steve and I teamed up with 3 colleagues from the University of Louisville School of Engineering who were very interested in kind of equal access to care. And we put together our own study. And what we did was we did an internet-based survey. Maybe some of the people in the audience took it. And it was really about how wheelchair users access and utilize healthcare services. And with the help of a couple of national organizations, the National Arthritis Foundation, the REE Foundation, we put the URL site out there. We asked people to take the survey, and we got about 450 responses nationwide. 108 of them were from people with spinal cord injuries. We asked about different aspects of their care. So this set of data, we asked about the quality of the physical examinations they received when they went into their primary care offices for their annual physical. And look at this. 84% of them were examined while they were fully clothed. 87% of them remained in their wheelchairs during their examination. Again, you know, my veins are popping. And over half of them felt that their examination was not thorough. And when this data came in, I couldn't believe 100% of them felt their examination was not thorough. But over half of them felt that way. We asked them about accessibility of their primary care facilities. And look at this. Again, very damning. 21% said that their primary care offices lacked accessible parking. Every strip mall in the country has accessible parking. 1/5 of our primary care offices don't. 1/3 of them said that they couldn't open the exterior doorways to their primary care offices. There weren't any hand swipes. They couldn't get in and out. 77% reported that the examination tables were inaccessible to them. 70% reported that there was a lack of proper transfer equipment, and 45% of them said that there were no staff able to help them with safe transfers. Now, regarding these last 2 data points, the ADA does not say that every medical office has to have a sling transfer or a slide board, but if they don't offer that, they have to have staff members who are trained to help safely transfer patients, and it seems like many of our primary care offices don't offer that. Now, we were kind of stuck on this issue of transfers and of thoroughness of examinations, so we digged a little deeper into this, and one aspect of our study, and these data are still unpublished, was we picked 30 outpatient medical facilities that are part of our kind of parent medical organization in the Louisville area, And we did kind of like a Sanchez type study on them. We called them in advance and we said, we want to come out. We have the support of the institution. They said, fine, that's good. We told them that we were going to measure their spaces looking for ADA compliance. And in advance, we asked them to identify some sort of clinical lead. So either an administrator who's in charge of the practice or a head nurse or a head medical assistant. And we said, when we come, we're going to interview you. So we went there and we picked, and you know, we met with these clinical leads, and when we went there, we asked them how the physicians in that practice examined wheelchair using patients, and 57% of them said that those patients were examined while they were still in their wheelchairs. And we said, do you have staff members who are able to assist patients with transfers onto table? 100% of them said that they had such staff members. A couple months later, we did something pretty sneaky. We called them up. We didn't tell them who we were, and we said, you know, this is Steve Williams, and I have an uncle who uses a wheelchair, and I want to bring him in for an exam. How are you going to examine him? 77% of them said that the doctors there would examine him while he's still in his wheelchair. So back to Sanchez, there's a reporting gap. And when we said, no, 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 we want you to get him onto an exam table. We feel he deserves a thorough examination. Do you have staff who can help transfer him? Only 15% said yes. And notably and disturbingly, several of those practices said, you're going to have to bring somebody yourself to get your relative up on the table. And you're shaking your head. That's a violation of the ADA. Almost 25 years after that law was passed. Huh?
It's infuriating.
It is infuriating. That's right. That's exactly what it is. And then we also did our own questionnaire about receipt of preventative care. And I know there are a lot of data on this slide, but a couple of things I wanted to point out to you. First of all, a good number of these folks with spinal cord injury were offered flu and pneumonia shots. And Steve and I both feel that's very important. So whenever you all go to your primary care doctors, even if you're not 65, say, give me an annual flu shot and give me a pneumonia shot right now. So we were encouraged by that. The data on dental care were interesting, so you all can imagine that nationally the data on receipt of preventative dental care is mixed. It's state by state, but nationally between 65 and 80% of people get annual dental checks. And then the numbers on pap smears were a little bit disappointing. So nationally, again, about 80% of women get pap smears every 3 years, which is in line with most national organizations' recommendations. And in our group of women with spinal cord injury, only 60% of them did. This, by the way, is in line with, again, that broader literature looking at how people with disabilities access and utilize healthcare. So that data seems to be pretty clear that women in particular do not receive, women with disabilities don't receive pap smears and mammograms at the same rate that women who don't have disabilities do. So, you know, it seems, you know, pretty obvious at this point that we have a problem, that patients living with disabilities and spinal cord injuries are telling us that our offices are inaccessible and that our staff and our physicians aren't kind of attuned to their needs. And we know that a lot of offices seem to be out of ADA compliance, and it seems that people living with disabilities and injuries aren't getting thorough physical exams and likely aren't getting preventative care at the same rate as people who don't have disabilities or spinal cord injuries. So, you know, we're both kind of like shaking our fists in the air and saying, who to blame for this travesty? Whose fault is this? And the answer is, it's Steve's, not mine. So, sorry, Steve, you're 3 under the bus. So there have only been a couple of studies looking at where people with spinal cord injuries go for their primary care, but the answer is they go to their physiatrist, not their internist. And I think Sue Bergman here tonight is going to have maybe something very interesting to say about that. So there was this study by Mark Johnston in 2005. He was out of the Kessler Center in New Jersey, and he had a cohort of 199 men living with spinal cord injuries. He asked them a lot about their health care, but one question he asked is, who do you consider to be your main doctor type? And look, there was about a 60-40 split between physiatrists and internists. So those men with injuries in New Jersey were going to Steve, not to me, for their primary care. In the Donnelly study, we had mentioned this one earlier. She's the woman in Canada who had teamed up with the folks in Colorado in the UK, not University of Kentucky. Also asked about how many people with injuries in the U.S. had what they would consider a family doc, and about 3/4 of them do. And yet, despite that, 68% of them say they would go to a physiatrist for an annual physical, not to a primary care doc or an internist, and over half of them said they would go to a physiatrist for routine blood work, not to me. So how do physiatrists feel about being primary care docs? Well, they're not interested in it. There's only been one study looking at this. This was done by Gerardo Francisco in 1995. And he asked physiatrists about their attitudes towards being primary care docs. And look at this. Only 39% of them thought physiatry should be a primary care specialty. And only about half of them thought they should be primary care docs, even for people with severe disabilities, or that they had the knowledge base to be primary care docs. So really, and again, I told you my PowerPoint skills aren't that good, so I was proud of myself just for being able to draw this and download it. But really, I think what Steve and I have realized is that it's time for a professional marriage between our two communities of physicians, between internists and physiatrists. We each have our own skill sets. Internists, as you know, are kind of, you know, very good at managing chronic disease, cardiometabolic disease, and endocrinologic disease, and sometimes, you know, acute flares of different conditions. And physiatrists are expert at handling complications of chronic spinal cord injury and at helping people with injuries regain maximal function after these devastating injuries. And so even though our skill sets don't necessarily overlap, they can really be brought together in a synergistic way to help provide better care than what we've been providing so far for people with spinal cord injuries. And with that, I'm going to turn the microphone over to Steve.
I'm actually going to change to the other microphone, which I think will be better for me. Can you hear me? Great. So those of you who know me, when I have, let me stabilize this, when I have been involved in these lectures before, know that I have a tendency to mumble. So it's better for me to have this on my tie than for me to hold that. So I'm delighted to be here. I'm just going to say that before. And it's so lovely to see so many of my old friends here tonight. So thank you all for coming. So as Michael said, we really believe that there should be a more perfect union between internal medicine and physiatry to care for people with spinal cord injury. And essentially what Mike and I did was write an article, which was recently published, and it was called A More Perfect Union, Reports from an Interdisciplinary Primary Care Clinic for Patients with Spinal Cord Injury. And I believe that several people here saw that article, and that is how we ended up being invited here tonight. So what I want to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about how we set up our clinic, and then after that I'm going to talk about this evaluation that Mike alluded to initially, and then I'm going to end with a little bit of the research that's going on at Fraser Rehab. So if any of you are interested, you may be able to participate there as well. Okay? So essentially, to develop a primary care clinic at Fraser was kind of a dream of ours. I had wanted to do this for a very long time at Boston Medical Center, but there was a lot of pushback at the time because of space issues, because of essentially ownership, who would help us with this, not in terms of us owning it, but how the institution would move it forward. And I was very disappointed that Boston Medical Center never seemed to be able to move this idea forward because of the restrictions that they had within their own system. And primary care for people with disabilities is very important. People with disabilities get sick the same way able-bodied people get sick. And so institutions need to respect that, and institutions need to provide the preventative care and the primary care for people who have disabilities. So as a politicist, I'm going to tell you, I hope that you will begin to demand this type of care at the institutions that you receive your care from. It is important. It will improve your quality of life, it will keep you healthy, and it will help you live longer. So wherever you are across this country or across this world, the take-home message for this talk is stand up as a group and demand the care that you deserve. So Mike and I decided that we would push for this at Fraser as we came together, and essentially what we had to do was get a commitment from the leadership in our two departments, which was rehabilitation medicine, which I oversaw that department, which made it easy, in particular spinal cord medicine, and also from the Department of Internal Medicine. And although I oversee spinal cord medicine at Fraser, I still needed to have buy-in at Fraser. And one of the things that was incredibly exciting for me was that Fraser Rehab saw the value of this, and they were very excited to begin it because Fraser Rehab has a strong interest in providing care throughout the continuum for people who have spinal cord injury. So we decided that we would do this clinic on site. As you saw earlier, the building at Fraser is relatively new. It's probably about 7 or 8 years old. It is much more traditional than this extremely beautiful building here at Spalding, but it is as well equipped and as spacious as this facility. It just looks much more traditional in Louisville. So we decided that on-site at Fraser was much more practical
than in the adult primary care building, because our space at Fraser was built for people with disabilities. So all of our rooms are large. We have scales to weigh people. We have Poyer lifts to transfer people. We have people who are trained to help with transfers. And we could do all of that. So it's a fully accessible facility. Also, one of the things that as we developed this, we decided that it would be truly just a primary care clinic for people with disabilities, spinal cord injury predominantly, but other disabilities as well. And that was very important for the chair of internal medicine, because he did not want us to set up a primary care clinic for those who were not disabled as well at Fraser, where people would be getting, where we would be drawing patients from the general primary care physicians group as well. So he wanted it to be a very specialized clinic, and we were happy to do that. After we were able to set it up, we decided that what we needed to do was really begin an education of primary care. And so we have provided lectures to other primary care physicians at the University of Louisville so that they realize that there is a primary care clinic for people with disabilities that is accessible, and this is where those patients should go. And we also began, although Mike had a great knowledge base of caring for people with spinal cord injury, because when we lived here, I would often send my patients who did not have primary care physicians to his office. One of the things as we began this clinic, Mike was very concerned that he have greater knowledge simply about spinal cord injury. He felt that he had the primary care knowledge, but he wanted more knowledge about the secondary complications of paralysis, etc. So what we decided was that we would have overlapping clinic schedules. So when I'm in clinic, Mike is in clinic. And our clinic offices where we're seeing patients, we each have two office spaces and they're side by side. So although we don't have a true interdisciplinary clinic running, we are both accessible to a patient at the same time. And occasionally, if we know that a patient has an issue where they will need both of us, we will see the patient together. But if something comes up that's a primary care issue that I don't feel comfortable with, and as Mike showed you earlier, a lot of physiatrists, we've taken on the responsibility of primary care, but we were not trained as primary care physicians. And so as Mike wanted to learn more about spinal cord injury, I needed to learn more about primary care and the recommendations for preventative care testing, et cetera, for patients. So, I'll knock on his door and I'll ask him questions and I'll say, can you come see this patient with me? Or he'll knock on my door and between my patients, I'll run in and see his patient with him. So it's worked out really beautifully, and I think our patients are very appreciative of it. And one of the things that we also worked out was how to bill this, and so that a patient, if they see us both, do not pay two copays, which is very expensive because insurance copays continue to rise. So we worked through our billing office as well so that if we see a patient together, there's one copay that's paid. So in terms of accessibility, as I said, we have Hoyer lifts, we have tables that raise to the appropriate height at Fraser, and we have wheelchair scales, and we use them all. The next step was that in providing primary care, we still want to be able to refer our patients to appropriate specialists, which may be OBGYNs for women who need pap smears. It may be to GI clinic where our patients may need to have colonoscopies as they age at 50, to GU or urology clinics, as well as to derm clinics. So we did a survey as well of the subspecialty clinics, and we decided that we would refer our patients to the clinics that were accessible within the University of Louisville facility. And we developed relationships with these providers so that we could have great communication. I can call or email one of them if I have a patient who needs to get in quickly, and it will happen. So I don't have to say I'll make you a urology appointment and hope that the urologist eventually schedule my patient and that they get in, but I can email directly and I can usually have an appointment by the time the patient leaves my office. And we don't refer to physicians who don't give us immediate and timely feedback. One of the things that we found also before developing this clinic and finding these specialists was lots of times if I sent my patients to a subspecialist, I may never get a note back, I may not have the communication. The next time the patient comes into my office, I'm calling, asking for the note to be faxed back to me. So it was very important for us that as we developed this, that we had people that we felt provided very good care, that their offices were also accessible, and that we knew that we would be able to receive timely feedback so that we could provide top-level care to our patients as well. And an example of the patients that we often send are young women and older women as well for GYN care. And this is a picture of one of the accessible tables on the right that we have in our GYN clinic at the University of Louisville. We also wanted to make sure that people with spinal cord injury knew about this special clinic, so we began an outreach to people with SCI, and we did local talks with our local chapter of the Spinal Cord Injury Association. And also, one of the things that's unique about Fraser is that when patients, we have patients who enroll from our catchment area, which is the 7 geographical states around Louisville, into our studies and who come for care. But we have patients also who come, who move to Louisville for periods of time to participate in therapy, because we provide lots of activity-based therapy in Louisville, which is becoming more commonplace across the country and across the world, but is really recovery-based and is really not compensatory therapy, which is training. Everybody needs compensatory therapy early when you're first injured, to learn how to transfer into your wheelchair, to learn how to dress yourself with adaptive equipment, et cetera. But we rapidly convert over to a recovery-based model, which is a little bit different. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when I talk about the therapies that we provide. But every patient who comes receives a mandatory evaluation in the primary care clinic, even if they have a primary care physician, because one of the things that we know is that many primary care physicians do not know about the medical complications of paralysis and how to prevent complications with their patients. So they receive this evaluation from me and from Mike, and Mike sends a comprehensive note to their primary care physician, which is a consultation about how to keep their patient healthy. And so we're not trying to steal their primary care patient from them, but we're trying to enhance their care, and we tell them that we're available to them as well for follow-up questions. And we also developed a patient-centered handbook on chronic complications of spinal cord injury. And this is a handbook that we developed in collaboration with the University of Kentucky Department of Rehabilitation Medicine, as well as the University of Louisville. And we are currently working to distribute this through one of the large foundations that does work with spinal cord injury. And with that book, we're hopeful that people who have spinal cord injury will be able to look at the book, that it'll be in lay language that you understand, and that you'll be able to advocate for care with your primary care physician that is appropriate for you, and that you'll know what to ask for. So now, this is a slide we call our Jedi level integration, in a reference to Star Wars. But our evaluation at Fraser is victory over paralysis. This is what we call it. And you can actually find this on a website, which is www.victoryoverparalysis.org. And this is a way to end up with a comprehensive evaluation at Fraser and to also sign up for studies at Fraser, including all the research studies. So VOP, victory over paralysis, is a fully integrated medical and research evaluation. It includes an evaluation by me, an SCI medicine physician, where I talk about bowel, bladder, we talk about neurogenic sexual dysfunction, we talk about skin, we talk about spasticity, we talk about pain, and I make suggestions for people. Then they have an evaluation by Dr. Stillman or Mike, where he does a full primary care evaluation. My evaluation also includes an ASIA classification, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the research tests that we do in ASIA classification, but as many of you know, ASIA classification is an imperfect tool for classifying spinal cord injury. So we also send patients for a bunch of laboratory tests. We look at vitamin D levels in men. We look at testosterone levels. We look at cholesterol levels. We look at a complete blood count. We look at chemistries, et cetera, and we compile a report to keep each patient healthy. The patients also receive an evaluation by physical and occupational therapy to look and see how you're doing, to make sure there are no contractures, to make sure your equipment is appropriate. And part of that evaluation is also an evaluation on the treadmill for stepping and standing. And then we do research testing, which I'm going to talk about, and then we make recommendations. So this is a 4-day evaluation. It starts on Monday morning at 9 a.m., and it ends on Thursday at noon with a meeting with Mike, Dr. Stillman, and Dr. Harkema. Dr. Stillman makes the recommendations for the medical component from myself and himself, and then Dr. Harkema interprets all of the research data and tells patients the tests, what the results of the research tests were and recommendations for research projects. And then you go home with a small book which describes on the top pages a summary of the findings in lay language and has all the medical components behind it for you, for your primary care physician at home, your physiatrist at home, and for any therapist, as well as for recommendations for therapy that are recovery-based. So with this evaluation, we've now actually seen 3 patients. They've come from all over the country. Our first was from California. The second was actually from London, England. And our third this past week was from Maine. And so we're scheduling these now. The testing and the evaluation is predominantly paid for by insurance. The cost of the evaluation is $5,000. And we find that probably about $4,000 of it is paid for by insurance, somewhere around $4,000. You would know before you come. So in the SCI medical evaluation, I told you what I'm looking for: a review of bladder and bowel, a review of neurogenic sexual dysfunction, skin, pain, spasticity. I also look at adaptive equipment and the full ASIA classification. The primary care physician looks at a detailed social, medical, surgical, family, and medication history. He performs a complete physical examination on the table, not in street clothes. He reviews the results of the labs, which I have ordered on Monday, and they're back for him when he does his evaluation on Wednesday, so he already has all your lab results back. He reviews those, and he writes a problem-specific note, including an educational review of cardiovascular health, endocrinologic health, and health maintenance considerations in spinal cord injury. So the laboratory testing that we look at is DEXA scanning for bone mineral density and looking at osteopenia and osteoporosis. We look at vitamin D testing. 50% of Americans, this is 50% of Americans, whether you're disabled or able-bodied, are vitamin D deficient. People who are vitamin D deficient then have a secondary effect that prevents them from making good bone, and you already have one impairment that helps you from making bone, which is your spinal cord injury. People with spinal cord injury lose up to 30% of their bone mineral density within the first 16 months after spinal cord injury. So you don't want a secondary cause for losing bone. And so we do vitamin D testing. We look at testosterone levels in males. As I said, cholesterol screening. We looked at kidney function and electrolytes. And we look at blood counts. Then we do the physical therapy evaluation, which includes a sitting and dynamic balance evaluation, a standing and stepping evaluation on the body weight treadmill system. So we want to look and see what types of body weight you can support on your own, and we also want to see if you can develop a reciprocal gait pattern. This is the theory behind locomotor training. So essentially in locomotor training, I don't know if you all heard of locomotor training, you may wonder why we do it. But in people who have upper motor neuron injuries or spinal cord injuries, develop spasticity and hyperreflexia. We believe that stepping is a reflex. In the spinal cord, there is something called a central pattern generator, and it's in the lower part of your spinal cord, and it's in the lumbosacral area. We know that stepping is a reflex because if you take a baby who's 5 or 6 months old and you hold the baby by its hands and put their feet on your legs, because of the sensory input into their feet, they begin to step. They're stepping not because they know how to walk, but they're stepping because the sensory input from their feet is traveling up their cord to their central pattern generator and generating this reflexive movement. That's what locomotor training is all about. It's that the spinal cord has memory of that and that we can encourage that reflexive movement to go on. Many of you know that the first studies with locomotor training were without baclofen. And the reason they were without baclofen is our thought that if spasticity is really sustained hyperreflexes, before your spinal cord injury, if you came to the doctor, I'd tap your knee and it'd go out like this. After your spinal cord injury, if I tap it, it goes out like this. Spasticity is sustained hyperreflexia. So if I'm using medications like baclofen to stop that moving, and that hyperreflexes, am I also inhibiting a stepping reflex, which is reflexive? So in all those early studies, we did not use baclofen. With time, we came to see that many patients have so much tone and spasticity that when you put them on the treadmill, they're so stiff, you can't actually move them through the stepping pattern. So now we're actually doing a study, which I'm the principal investigator of, looking at treadmill training with baclofen, because there may be some patients who would benefit from it. So not that it inhibits the stepping, but maybe it inhibits the tone just enough so that the stepping can occur. So we're looking at that, and that's what this stepping and standing evaluation is all about. We review ADL functioning, and we also look at upper extremity functioning. And there's a whole protocol now with the Neuro Recovery Network for upper extremity recovery using electrical stimulation as well. So the research testing, there are four tests that we do, and I'm going to explain them. The first one is called the FMPA. It stands for Functional Neurophysiological Assessment. We also do something called Biodex testing, which I'll explain in a moment. And we also do something called the RMCA, which is Respiratory Motor Control Assessment for breathing. I'll explain why that's important. And the Respiratory Motor Control Assessment and cardiovascular testing are together because the pulmonary and the respiratory system work hand in hand. So the functional neurophysiological exam is essentially a very sophisticated ASIA exam. Essentially, what we do is patients are hooked up with surface EMG electrodes that can detect muscle activity. And the goal of the test is to quantitatively and qualitatively describe or document a person's ability to relax and to activate muscles below the level of spinal cord injury, picking this up using surface EMG. It does not necessarily correlate with ASIA, and I think this is really important because one of the things, there are two things that we have found with this and with one of our research projects, epidural stimulation, is that many of the people who with ASIA exam are called ASIA A's are truly not ASIA A's. There is still connectivity. So essentially, with this test, as you're laying there, we go through the 10 key muscle groups that are tested in ASIA. And we ask you to relax the muscle, and then we look to see if you can activate the muscle. We say, can you move that muscle? And on the bottom of the slide shows you muscle activation that you can pick up with surface EMG. Where it looks large is the muscle activity. Where it looks flat is the muscle at rest. One of the things that we find with muscle connectivity, sometimes we ask people to move a muscle and they can't. But there are several moves that you can do. Of course, the name of the move just popped out of my head, but I can describe it. This is what happens when you turn 50. I turned 50 this year, and now I can't remember anything. But essentially, there is a move where I can put my hand on your forehead and I can ask you to flex forward. When you flex forward, you can activate muscles below your neurological level of injury. The question is, if you can do it repeatedly with rest and flexing forward on command, it shows that you're able to activate some muscle movement. Now, the muscle may not move, and the question is that movement spasticity? Is that pushing forward actually causing spasticity? But spasticity, the waveform looks very different than activated muscle. So with the surface EMG, we can tell the difference. And so if we see that, we often believe that patients have some connectivity in the cord. I'm going to explain why that becomes even more of a reasonable thought with epidural stimulation in just a moment. But with this test, there are many people who we may have thought were ASIA A who truly are not ASIA A, but have some connectivity in the cord. Of course, if we know they have that connectivity, then our next question is, how can we stimulate that connectivity and how can we make that connectivity functional? The second test is BioDEX testing, and it really looks at strength, but we call it torque. And essentially, we are looking at it using electrical stimulation. Many of you may have had functional electrical stimulation, or FES. So it's similar to that, but the stimulation is at much higher wavelength and frequency. So essentially, you're hooked up once again with electrodes, and you're sitting in the chair, and we look at 8 major muscle groups. The right and left knee extensors, the right and knee left, right and left knee flexors, and the right and left ankle plantar flexors and dorsiflexors. And essentially, what we do is we begin with a patient's maximal voluntary contraction, and we're looking at that. And then we stimulate and we look at maximal muscle contraction. And so, what we're trying to do is, as patients, we look at this tool once again to see if there's muscle movement. But in patients who are participating in activity-based therapy where we're trying to encourage neuroplasticity, so therapies which are activity-based may be things like locomotor training or neuromuscular electrical stimulation. Neuromuscular electrical stimulation is similar to functional electrical stimulation, except functional electrical stimulation works at the muscle level, and neuromuscular electrical stimulation is higher frequency, larger waveform, so it's much higher electrical stimulation. And the thought is that you are pushing the electrical stimulation back up to the peripheral nerve where it comes off of the spinal cord to the motor neuron pool where motor movement is stimulated. And so we have had some really great improvement in patients using neuromuscular electrical stimulation. And we did this with the people from RTI who make the bikes. And we are now asking for FDA approval to use this higher electrical stimulation in other patients so that it could be done at other centers from ours. But essentially, when we're doing this activity-based therapy, we're trying to super excite the nervous system. And we're trying to get muscles moving. And lots of times when we see muscles moving, we can't feel it with our fingers, but with torque testing and this intense stimulation, we can see muscle movement because we're recording it just like we did with the FMPA. The other two tests that we talked about were the RMCA, which was respiratory motor control assessment. So many people with spinal cord injury have a difficult time generating a breath that is large enough to cough, to sneeze, and also to have a large volume voice. We have found that one of our MD PhDs, Alex Ovechkin, runs this study, which is from the Department of Defense, and essentially he developed a device which has resistance both with inhalation and exhalation. And so we do 20 sessions of inhalation and exhalation therapy with our patients, and we measure their forced expiratory volume. And we found that we've been able to increase their forced vital capacity. And with increasing their forced vital capacity, we've improved cough and we've improved voice quality. So that's what RMCA is. And we also look at cardiovascular function during that to see what's happening with blood pressure and heart rate. So those are done. So as these research tests are completed, we then come back and we make recommendations for recovery-based therapy, which I have described just a moment ago, which is the body weight-supported treadmill training with or without baclofen, the neuromuscular electrical stimulation program, which can be done standing or not standing. We were previously doing it without standing, people actually on bikes getting high dose neuromuscular electrical stimulation, but we've actually now started standing people in a harness over the treadmill, having them support body weight and doing neuromuscular electrical stimulation, and we're finding that we're getting more movement, probably because we're getting sensation through the feet as well as the neuromuscular electrical stimulation. We're having greater neuroplasticity occur. As well, we have our epidural stimulation protocol, which is probably one of the things that most of you have heard about and may be interested in hearing about. And we have an additional 50 SCI research protocols going on at Fraser. So there are many, many, many research protocols. So when patients come and they go through this evaluation, We give them this pamphlet as they take home, and it tells them projects that they may participate in either at Fraser or may be able to participate at home. And if they're not able to participate in those projects at home, maybe there are physical therapy suggestions that are activity-based that they can take home with them to do with their therapist. So the neuromuscular electrical stimulation program is monitored through the internet. So you could take home, if you have an RTI bike, you could take home the neuromuscular electrical stimulation program, and you could use those higher waveforms and frequency because you're in our study and we're monitoring you from a distance. So you could participate in that research program and not be in Louisville. Many of the patients come to Louisville, though, to participate in a variety of these research programs. And when you come to Louisville, there is an outpatient case manager and a social worker who will help with housing. We have negotiated rates with hotels within a three-block radius of Fraser, which are fully accessible. I lived in one, Mike and I lived in one when we first moved to Louisville for a month while our house was being completed, the Residence Inn. And they are negotiated rates, which make it much more affordable. So I want to show you this video about victory over paralysis, and we'll talk more about it in just a moment.
I played college baseball for Oregon State University and won the College World Series in 2006 with them. I was struck by a hit-and-run driver. I was told that I was paralyzed and would never feel or move anything from my chest down.
I got ejected from a vehicle because I wasn't wearing a seatbelt, and that left me paralyzed from the chest down.
When he was 2 years and 3 months, Caden was hit by a car. The neurosurgeon said he might move one arm, but paralyzed from the chest down and not able to walk again.
So the initial prognosis for me was you're basically never going to be able to move your hands or your arms. Pretty much paralyzed me from the chest down.
My motor locked up on my bike, and it caused it to land nose down. Well, the doctors came in and they explained to me that there was no hope for me to regain any mobility or movement, that I needed to learn how to live from the wheelchair. That just wasn't how it was supposed to be.
The Kentucky Spinal Cord Injury Research Center is unique in that we have a continuum of care and cure. Without that partnership, we wouldn't be able to take the scientific knowledge and bring it to the patients as quickly and as effectively as we can.
Patients who have spinal cord injury have the opportunity to come to Fraser and really receive cutting edge treatment, but also cutting edge science delivered to them.
You can do science here in a lab, you can have a finding, you have evidence, and you walk right across the hallway and you put it to use.
It's absolutely at the cutting edge of the field of neurorestoration and neurorehabilitation.
I've been to a number of centers around the country, and by far the University of Louisville Fraser Rehab has been the best services and training I've received anywhere.
We used to think that when you had a spinal cord injury or a brain injury or any other neurologic injury that resulted in paralysis, there was really nothing you could do. But what we know now is that, in fact, the spinal cord can function very well even when there's severe loss of input from the brain.
We retrain the spinal cord. Spinal cord is much like the brain. It can think, it can learn.
The closer we can approximate that experience of walking, the better the nervous system is going to recognize it and say, hey, we're walking, and generate a motor output very similar to that.
To see the things that have happened with him since we've been here, it's just, it's amazing. He's able to sit up, he's got trunk control. I've seen him move his legs, I've seen him move his hips. We were told for so long that this stuff wouldn't happen, that after a year or two of injury, you reach a plateau. So seeing these things, it's very remarkable. It gives you hope.
We are the only site in the world that has done epidural stimulation in people with severe spinal cord injury. We combine the epidural stimulation with retraining, sending sensory signals back to the spinal cord about walking or standing or whatever we want the movement to be. And when we do that over and over, we can regain really high levels of function that weren't possible before we had that knowledge. We've implanted 4 people so far, people who had been completely paralyzed, couldn't move for over 2 years, and all 4 of them now can move, but only when the stimulator's on.
Left leg up, left leg down.
Right leg up, right leg down.
Once you're not able to stand on your legs and you go so long without being able to stand up by yourself, and you have the stimulator and you turn it on and you just stand up on your own, and it's just like, I'm standing.
So I've gotten a lot of function back, including my hands. I've gotten back the ability to stand, move my toes, ankles, knees, hips, all on command. I've gotten back a very good sensation and feeling, as well as the other things that a lot of people don't think about. Bladder function, bowel function, sexual function, the ability to sweat. The epidural stimulation project is the definition of victory over paralysis. It is working on quality of life today while finding the cure for tomorrow.
We want to help train other scientists, other clinicians to be able to provide this, not just in the United States, but worldwide.
This is one of those breakthrough technologies that make a difference in people's lives. This is an investment, this is a team effort, this is terrific.
You've got a research and a scientific community that is winning. They're not just getting functional recovery in patients, they're getting true victory over paralysis.
My experience here has been life-changing.
And I feel like we've really conquered a lot of things that people thought were impossible.
Frazier's doing remarkable things, and I think that everybody needs to know what is happening here. It's an answer.
The gentleman who spoke,
the man who was the baseball player, as well as Kent, who was the motocross, by Asia classification, they were Asia A's. They were motor. The baseball player was a C6 Asia A, and Kent was a T5 Asia A. Essentially, when we did FMPA, we thought we saw connectivity. When the epidural stimulator was placed, if there had been no connectivity, we wouldn't have movement up and down, and there would have been no fibers left if there had been an Asia A injury. When we think about what we call Asia A essentially means that the majority or all of the cells at the level of injury died. Asia B's, which are also motor complete, means that the majority or all the cells at the level of injury also died. With epidural stimulation, we see that there are, even in Asia A's and B's, some motor function still left or some fiber still left. And with epidural stimulation, which is simply a spinal cord stimulator that had been used for pain, but now we provide supercharged electricity, we're able to get voluntary movement. And with retraining, we have been able to get people to have greater voluntary movement and stepping. With retraining. So I just wanted to say that being called Asia A by Asia classification isn't necessarily true. That I actually suspect that unless you have truly severed your cord, which is very unusual, Asia A probably does not exist. So I am happy to take any questions. Mike is happy to take questions. And if you are interested in any of these research projects, you can come to www.victoryoverparalysis.org. If you are interested in an evaluation, as I talked about, you can also visit Victory Over Paralysis, and someone will call you back. In the comments section, just say you want a Victory Over Paralysis evaluation.
Are any of your research protocols applicable to patients who have ischemic damage rather than an injury in a specific spot?
Yes. So all of the projects are open to people who have had spinal cord injury from any cause, ischemic,
hemorrhage, stroke, traumatic, etc. And we have been, all the projects are open to both people with quadriplegia and paraplegia. And there are, as I said, there are over 50 protocols. So there are some that fit some people more than others. So you may get triaged into various, but epidural stimulation is open. There's also something called cardiovascular epidural stimulation. One of the great things about epidural stimulation that we found was that people have better blood pressure control, just feel better and have less fatigue. So the Helmsley Foundation and the Nielsen Foundation have funded a cardiovascular epidural stimulation project to implant 4 patients. We implanted the 5th patient this past Wednesday with an epidural stimulator. The Reeve Foundation is raising $15 million and will implant 36 additional patients.
Just a couple of comments. I get a lot of my primary care at Leahy, and I find it's helpful to have stuff at a large hospital just because that way all the doctors can compare notes without having to worry about all the HIPAA crap, which I find is really a much of a bother for sharing medical information because of all of the consent stuff. And I'm not always upset about being examined or treated in my chair. There's a lot of things that I don't need to transfer, and why go through the effort if it's not necessary? And I find my care doctors, they basically, they ask me, you know, do I feel I need to transfer? And if I do, they do come up with it. A minor pet peeve is I have found very few medical offices that have wheelchair parking in the waiting rooms. They kind of stick you in the aisle or whatever, that they're just all these chairs and no place to put a wheelchair. The other question is, what do you do for people who do not respond to STEM? I've been told I have lower motor neuron damage, and they have shocked me with all sorts of stuff at different times, and I have never once moved a muscle from being shocked.
I'm going to take the first question, and then I'm going to take a quick crack at the second question and maybe turn it back over to Steve. My answer to your first question is that you ought to be offended if you are not occasionally undressed and transferred onto a table and have somebody give you a very thorough examination. I saw a gentleman recently in Kentucky who had been to a cardiologist. I ran a stethoscope over him. I heard what's called a bruit, which is when you listen over a blood vessel and you hear an abnormal noise which indicates blockage, and he had an enormous blockage in one of the arteries in his neck, and he went for what's called a carotid endarterectomy because he was at a very high risk for stroke. His cardiologist had never listened to his neck with a stethoscope. Now, this is an indictment of the medical community. We're none of us doing the same quality physical exams that our predecessors did or that we ought to be doing. But somebody has to do a skin check on you. Somebody has to do a belly exam on you. Somebody has to do a thorough cardiovascular exam on you. I'm absolutely convinced that you cannot be adequately evaluated while you're sitting in your chair with your clothes on.
Just as an example, I had a pressure sore on my foot.
Right.
They could take a look at my pressure sore on my foot just as easily while I'm sitting in my chair as having me transfer. When I have a physical, they have me transfer, but like I said,
yeah.
It's kind of, they ask me because, you know, some people it's more of a pain or discomfort to transfer.
That's true,
so.
But I think as long as occasionally somebody's taking a complete look at you and making sure you're getting a thorough exam, that's fine. The question about stimulation with lower motor neuron injuries is a very interesting one, and we're working with a couple of folks at Fraser right now who have lower motor neuron injuries and trying, higher intensity electrical stimulation. It's a very tricky problem. We may be getting a little bit of response in a couple of them, but that study is in its infancy.
So I'd also say about electrical stimulation, one of the things is you probably had functional electrical stimulation, which doesn't have the higher waveforms and the higher frequency. One of the things is neuromuscular electrical stimulation is different, which is the one that we're actually just doing now at Fraser that we're looking for FDA approval for. And the difference is that functional electrical stimulation is at the muscle level, and neuromuscular electrical stimulation is at the motor neuron pool level, which is where the nerve first comes off the cord. One of the things is stimulating those cells is important because if they do not receive any sensory input, the motor neuron pool can die. And so, you know, we like to go back and try to do that. We've actually had, I personally have had 5 patients who we called Asia B who had lower motor neuron injuries, T12, T11,
and L2 who we've stimulated with neuromuscular electrical stimulation, and I'm not saying that this happens in every patient by any means, but those five have recovered the ability to walk and walk without bracing or devices. One of the things at Fraser that we do not do is we do not brace people, because we feel that a brace is compensation. If we put a brace on you, like an AFO to walk, that muscle that we're compensating for is never going to be activated. It's never going to have to work. The brace is always going to do the work. So we don't use a bracing at Fraser. So in our lower motor neuron injured patients, we actually never use bracing, and we do this high voltage electrical stimulation. There are other patients who have not had as great a recovery, but I do think that neuromuscular electrical stimulation is promising. We've had one case report with it, and we're getting ready to write a paper about it.
Other questions? I had a question. I've taken calcium with vitamin D, 600 milligrams of calcium, for ages and ages due to the osteopenia. And the last time I had my blood work with my primary, he told me that my D is too high and I need to cut back on the D. So what would be a disadvantage of having too much D?
Do you know what your vitamin D level was?
He said it was like 3 times higher than it was supposed to be.
That's okay. That's fine. You can get complications from having very, very high vitamin D levels. But studies have shown that, and maybe Leslie can answer this as well, I think you can't get vitamin D toxic in... Don't quote me. Don't if I'm giving you wrong information. But I think if you have to take like 10,000 international units of vitamin D a day, so it's an enormous amount of vitamin D.
It wouldn't be likely to cause stones. Maybe no.
So I'm going to differ in my opinion slightly from Mike. I would like people to keep their vitamin D levels in the normal range. You can become vitamin D toxic. Vitamin D is very important for us because it helps us absorb calcium. And so we know that calcium can be related with kidney stones and with constipation. Taking excess amounts of calcium or vitamin D for somebody with spinal cord injury induced osteoporosis is not going to reverse it. It's not going to give us the osteogenic, the bone building response that we need to build bone. And so there is an appropriate amount of calcium and vitamin D that is necessary, and that actually varies, you know. People in my osteoporosis clinic will hear me talk about the right timing of supplementing calcium and vitamin D. So in the first couple of years after a spinal cord injury, your calcium level is very high and your vitamin D level is very low. That's not a good time really for us to be supplementing, right? So 3 to 5 years after your spinal cord injury, everybody needs an appropriate amount of calcium and vitamin D. But we don't want to take excess amounts.
Somebody's level is over 30. Do you think an appropriate amount is like 1 to 2,000 international units a day? Something.
So no, I look at everybody as, you know, it's not the level, it's the individual, right? And so it's your renal function, it's your vitamin D level, it's your age, it's your gender, it's your years post-injury, and then I would make a recommendation for supplementing. So it's something that has to be really kind of, I think it's important to think about every individual and make a recommendation tailored to that. So I do tend to supplement most people who have vitamin D levels below 30 nanograms per milliliter. But it also depends on the season also. Are we in the wintertime in Massachusetts, or are we in the summertime? Can I tell you to go outside and get 10 minutes of sunlight exposure in the summertime and come back in a couple of months? Because, you know, once you start supplementing people, it's just something to keep an eye on.
And I just had a real quick comment for Dr. Steve. Having a very low spinal cord injury, I wear an AFO on one leg and a KFO on the other leg. And it totally assists in transferring. I would not be able to stand without it. So I'm kind of in favor of bracing.
And I would say that that is an individual choice. And, you know, it also may depend upon how long you've been injured. And if we can say we know each other well, and I think that that is appropriate for you. I think that, you know, when somebody is newly injured, before I would put them, and I should make that exclusion, that I'm not saying that no one needs AFOs or KFOs, but somebody who's newly injured, I would try to get recovery. But there are points where I prescribe AFOs and KFOs, but I'm looking to see if I can get the maximal recovery of every muscle, because AFOs and KFOs can help with function. So I may have misled you, and I'm not trying to say that they're a bad thing. I'm just saying, if you're newly injured, let's see if we can force recovery. And if we get to the point that we've had the maximal recovery and you still need a brace, then we should use it.
We have some questions on the webcast. And one is, as a patient, how can I facilitate communication between PCP, physiatrist, and other physicians beyond a resource manual? As you stated, and as I've experienced, there's a large disconnect. Are there programs that could be standard protocol for all SCI patients? Maybe there's a way for certain physicians to be certified in disability care.
This has actually been discussed in certain circles, if we should have a one-year fellowship training program after people do residencies in internal medicine or family medicine to beef up their skills in caring for folks with disabilities. It's certainly, I think, not on the near horizon. In terms of facilitating communication, I think, it's a great question you ask. It's not really yours to facilitate. I think the best answer to that is that you have to tell your primary care physician that he or she needs to do as good a job as he or she can in terms of coordinating your care and ensuring open communication. And if that physician is not able to do it, you have to seek another one. One of the reasons we wanted to give this talk is because I think, you know, what we're trying to do, I mean, this is really a patient-centered talk, but we're also giving similar talks at rehab centers around the country and hoping that rehab centers will hire internists, even for just, you know, a few hours a week, where they can come in and they can offer primary care services in these fully accessible facilities to folks with disabilities. And I think, you know, if we could get 50 rehab centers around the country to do that, well, wouldn't that be great? So I think really part of it has to do with the medical community's response to an unmet need.
And I would also say that a handbook does not accomplish the goal, as the person online said. But one of the things about the handbook is that it's in lay language, so it's meant to educate people who have spinal cord injury about the care they need, and you can always advocate for yourself. You can say, I think I'm 50, I need to have a colonoscopy. You can remind your physician, you know, if they're not offering it to you. So that's what the handbook is meant to do. But I think, as Mike said, one of our goals is to have this really move across the country. But in some way, you can always advocate for yourself. I think Dr. Bergman has a question.
It is really wonderful to see you, and it's a pleasure to see what a great job you guys are doing. It's awesome. The barriers, I think, are not so much that the physicians aren't thinking about it, or they don't want to, or even that patients aren't advocating for themselves. One big barrier that I can see is insurance companies. People, you know, the HMOs who think 12 sessions of physical therapy is more than enough for anybody. The barriers I'm having for my patients is getting air mattresses for people who don't already have stage 3 or stage 4 decubiti. Any words of wisdom on how we can change that culture, this sort of short-term way of looking at the world? Because you're right, for anybody, exercise at all stages of life, no matter what is going on with you medically, is going to make you feel better, it's going to make you function better, and it's going to make you healthier. The trouble is, if you can't afford a gym membership, or the gym doesn't have a hydraulic lift, or you can't get there, what do you do?
That's a hard question. I'm going to let him answer it. But I just want to say to the people in this room and to people who may be watching this webcast, that was Dr. Sue Bergman, and she trained Steve and was one of his most important mentors, and was also a very important mentor to me when I was in medical school. And I said Steve was really a treasure of the Boston medical community. I mean, that woman trained everybody in the city. So thank you for coming.
Absolutely. And I would not be a spinal cord injury physician without her. She is the person who made me realize what an absolutely wonderful area of medicine spinal cord medicine is, and thank you. So, one of the things that all of your comments are very valid, and Medicare has become tighter and Medicaid has become tighter, and essentially what happens is all third-party insurance companies follow their lead. So with Medicare now, you can get 22 visits of physical therapy per year. And that's it, whether you're spinal cord injured or you have a rotator cuff muscle tear. So one of the things I think that we as a group have to do is to begin to lobby, which seems impossible. But I know that there are organizations like the Reeve Foundation who are beginning to come together in a grassroots way to move this forward. And I think that some of the things that seem impossible really aren't impossible. And I'm in Massachusetts, which is very liberal, and I'm a very liberal person, so I'm going to make a statement about this. When I lived in Massachusetts, when I first moved here in 1995, Mike and I had some friends who were a lesbian couple, and they said, we're going to get married. And I was like, that's crazy. That's never going to happen. And look at us now. So, as a group of people with spinal cord injury, we can start a grassroots movement that is just as powerful. Those two women actually started the right to marry in Massachusetts. They were able to move that forward here. They were women who were determined. So they had the idea, they moved it forward in Massachusetts, they began to support it nationally, it started nationally, and now there are 35 states where same-sex partners can be married. We can start a similar grassroots movement. This is the thing from the Reeve Foundation. If we don't even think about spinal cord injury, but we think, I sat on that National Paralysis Task Force that did the study and found that there are 5.6 million people in the U.S. living with some form of paralysis, 1.3 million being spinal cord injured. If there are essentially 6 million people in the U.S. living with paralysis, and there are 300 million people, that's 1 in 50 people have some form of paralysis in America, which means we have a big, big voice when we come together. So I think that we all need to figure out ways, and we need to find a leader. And I'm not sure who that leader is going to be, but we need to find a leader who is going to take this on and who is going to push it and who is going to demand that healthcare companies provide the care that people with severe disabilities need.
We have another webcast question.
Sure.
And that is, how do they choose the 36 new patients? And can you tell us a little bit about the protocol for qualifying for the phase two trial?
So there's a series of evaluations. So initially, you go onto the Victory Over Paralysis website, and essentially it's going to ask you some data. It's going to get your very basic data, which includes your age and your phone number and your contact information. It's going to ask you what you think your entry level is, et cetera. So the first four patients, so we've started to implant the next four. So the first four, the next four have already been chosen because we age and injury match them to the first four, okay? So after that, essentially, patients are identified. I suspect they will be identified based on the type of injury they have, because right now we're doing it in motor complete injuries. And some other biographical information. People will be called from that database, which we call our purple database. And people will be called, and they would be evaluated. We're actually, every Monday morning from 10 to 12, we have research clinic, and I evaluate four patients for various trials every Monday morning. And that doesn't include the VOP. That's just evaluation. And those patients are being evaluated for epidural stimulation as well. And essentially, you go through a series of testing. You have to be able to commit to essentially a year and a half study in Louisville, where you do 80 sessions of locomotor training to train you before epidural stimulation. You get implanted, and then you do 80 more sessions, and then a bunch of various training and experiments. So it's a long process. It takes great commitment. It takes people who are able to go the course and not be frustrated. And so there's some psychological testing as well to make sure that, because you can't really implant somebody when it costs almost $400,000 and they decide they don't want to participate afterwards. So, you know, there's a lot of soul searching for every patient that's implanted, and there has to be a great commitment to participating and that you're able to participate. There are funds that help people be in the Louisville area for the study, though. So the next four have been chosen. As I said, they were age and injury level matched. And then the next will be chosen from the Purple database. Dr. Bergman.
Thanks. Just had one more comment. I really like your idea. And I would say in terms of leadership, it takes a village. And the very model that you guys started was reaching across lines and having a team, pulling a team together who can bring their skills together and brainstorm. This is too big for one person. And I think it's a great idea. I kind of wish there was a Facebook page or lobbying. I think this has a lot of potential, and we should all really think this through. The technology is giving us a lot of opportunity that we didn't have before.
That's true. Maybe we should call some type of conference. We could find somebody to do a little sponsorship, and we could have some type of conference where we bring people together who want to push changes in healthcare.
Hi, I noticed in your list of tests that you provide, you have a testosterone test, and I was wondering two things. Is our community different for testosterone levels, and do you
also test for estrogen or similar levels in women, and what are you looking for?
This is a complicated question. So yes, men with spinal cord injuries tend to have lower testosterone levels. I've looked at a lot of the studies, and I think about between 30% and 50% of men with spinal cord injuries wind up having low testosterone levels, whether or not they have symptoms from it. So in a general medical population, we don't really test men for testosterone deficiency or androgen deficiency unless they say, you know, I'm losing muscle mass, or I feel really tired, or my hair distribution is changing, all that in conjunction maybe with erectile dysfunction. But, supplementation of testosterone recently has become a little bit controversial. It's very important for bone preservation? Okay, good. I'm getting the green light from Leslie. For preservation of some other, metabolic and endocrinologic systems, there's been some controversy about whether supplementing men with testosterone leads to cardiovascular risk. I think the jury is still out on that, and I think most endocrinologists would say that if you supplement them to normal levels, they're fine. So we just screen men for low testosterone levels because androgen deficiency is so prevalent in men with spinal cord injury. We do not look at estrogen levels in women. I think that is an area of research that's lacking. I just don't think that is as much as known about women's sex hormones in spinal cord injury. You're nodding knowingly. Right, across the field in healthcare, right? Women are historically underrepresented in research studies and underappreciated. So that's why we do it. Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's I'm sorry. Thank you for your wonderful lecture on spinal cord injury. I'm a spinal cord injury physician from China. And one of my patients recently emailed me to ask a question. I haven't encountered that before, so I here to ask you for some advice. It's a female of C5 Asia A spinal cord injury patient for 5 years. Now 35 years old, want to have a baby, you know. She has been pregnant and want maybe have a cesarean section and to have the baby. Asked me what should she pay attention to during the surgery, maybe.
So actually, women with spinal cord injury do not need to have a cesarean section to have a baby. They can have a normal vaginal delivery. And if the injury is above T6, the person who's delivering just needs to be aware that the person could have autonomic dysreflexia. So if the injury level is above T6, the person just needs to have epidural anesthesia so that they don't become dysreflexic. But most women with spinal cord injury have normal vaginal deliveries. And if any of you are interested who may be listening to this or in the audience, we actually have a spinal cord injury and pregnancy study at the University of Louisville that is being run by Amy Jackson from Alabama, but I am the co-investigator at U of L. So it's hard to find women who are planning to have a baby or are having babies. So if you're interested, please be in touch.
Okay, one more quick question. I'm now participating in a spinal cord injury project in the Harvard Medical School. It's about a cell which is extracted from the mice brain. It has been proved to be successful as the interneuron to reduce the neurogenic pain of spinal cord injury. We are now trying to inject the cell into the injury site of the spinal cord to make sure if it can act as an interneuron to relay the signal for above the injury level to the below the level. So what's your opinion about the future of the cell-based therapy for the spinal cord injury?
So I believe that cell-based therapy is very important. I believe that true cure from spinal cord injury is going to be multifactorial. I think that there will probably be stem cells and electrical stimulation and epidural stimulation and good old physical therapy.
What effect does the epidural stimulation have on neuropathic pain?
So we do look at quality of life, and obviously neuropathic pain is part of quality of life. And almost every patient, as you probably know, has some neuropathic pain who has spinal cord injury. I think that neuropathic pain is probably one of the greatest complications and most common complications after spinal cord injury. The patients who have had epidural stimulation have not necessarily had improvement in neuropathic pain, but it hasn't been made worse. You know, one of the things I'm very curious as well about neuropathic pain, and I'm very curious about some of the stem cell projects that are being done in other countries. And, you know, I've, as any spinal cord injury physician would tell you, we've all had patients who have probably gone outside of the U.S. for stem cell transplant. All the patients that I have seen who have had stem cell transplant, and it just may be the bias of the patients I've seen, so I don't mean to offend anybody who may be listening to this webcast, has been that they have mostly had an increase in sensation, which has been painful sensation. But we haven't seen that necessarily with epidural stimulation, which is good. You know, one of the things about therapy as well and neuropathic pain, which I see all the time, I see sometimes neuromuscular electrical stimulation increasing neuropathic pain, but I don't see epidural stimulation increasing it. And if you think about it, neuropathic pain is caused because the peripheral nerve is hyperexcited because it's getting a strange message from the spinal cord. And so it becomes hyperexcited, sends its own message out, which is perceived as numbness, tingling, pins and needles, electrical, shooting, fiery. And with neuromuscular electrical stimulation, we're actually hyperexciting the nerve. So sometimes people who have neuropathic pain feel that their pain does worsen with neuromuscular electrical stimulation, but not with epidural stimulation.
I was injured 4 years ago, as you know. And in the past 4 years, I've put in a tremendous amount of effort in strengthening my legs, and I'm able to stand and walk at the present time. But my balance is non-existent. And have you any recommendations on how I can attack that problem?
So balance is difficult. Balance is interesting because balance is complex, as you know. So balance involves both proprioception, or knowing where your foot is in space. And sometimes those fibers are damaged in the cord, the dorsal column fibers. But also, if you think about it, your center of gravity is 2 centimeters in front of your S2 vertebrae, so it's down here. And if you're standing straight up and you're perfectly aligned, your balance may be better. But in many people who have spinal cord injury, they have hip weakness, pelvic girdle weakness. And so when they stand and they put their whole body weight on, it shifts back like this.
And when it shifts back, it moves your center of gravity, which makes balance more difficult as well. So a program, if you have hip weakness, that works on strengthening your hip pelvic girdle to bring you into alignment is important. And I do think that some people can compensate over the proprioception. I actually have a patient who has had very good recovery in Louisville, walks without assistive device. If you looked at her, you would think that she has not had a spinal cord injury. She has no proprioception, but she can run. She jogs. I don't know how she does it, but somehow I think that you can. It's probably more, it's probably individualized. But I think pelvic and hip girdle strengthening is very important.
When I'm on my feet, it feels as if I'm standing on air cushions.
Mm-hmm. So the sensation is abnormal, and it's probably hard sometimes for you to know exactly where your foot is when you're walking. And so sometimes people's feet turn onto the edge, and they may step on the edge, or sometimes the step is too big or too short, et cetera, and that's proprioception. And that is hard to recover, but there are some people who are able to adapt. Anyone else? Thank you so much for being here this evening and letting us come and see all of you. And for those of you who are listening out around the world, I hope that you found the lectures informative and that you gained some information that will improve your quality of life and your health. Thank you so much.